amazing. Thank you guys. You guys really loving the energy out here. All right. Can I have everyone please stand as we get ready for prayer? I want you guys to get quiet, you know, and open up your hearts. Thank you. All right, so here we go. Can you follow me? In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. God, who knows our hearts.
We strive, you inspire.
We intend, you challenge.
We forget, you forgive.
We fail, you love.
Help us, Lord Jesus, to be more like you.
Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. All right, guys, hello again. My name is, have a seat. All right, once again, hello. My name is Ramwell, and this here is Gabby. We are from Sacred Heart Church in Lancaster, and welcome to LA Youth Day. Go ahead.
Today, we are pleased to welcome Bishop Caggiano here today. He will be giving us a talk about being the hands and feet of God.
Real quick, Bishop Caggiano was installed as fifth bishop of Bridgeport on Thursday, September 19, 2013, at St. Teresa Church in Trumbull, Connecticut.
Also, in his installation homily, the bishop spoke of the need to build bridges to the youth, to all those who are troubled and neglected, and to Catholics who no longer participate in the life of the church.
With that, I ask that you please give your attention and listen to the good word he has to share with us today. Now please help me welcome Bishop Caggiano.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for those kind words of introduction. Why don't we give our MCs a round of applause? They did a great job. My friends, I'm very happy to be here today to share faith with you. As you can tell from my accent, I am not a native from the West Coast. I was born and raised in Brooklyn, USA. And I am, as you heard, the Bishop of Bridgeport in Connecticut. This is my second visit to the West Coast and my first visit to Anaheim. So thank you for your hospitality, my friends. Thank you. I am here to spend about 45 minutes with you to address a challenge Pope Francis has given us, a challenge that you and I are going to have to face every day of our discipleship. The challenge can be expressed in many different ways, but Francis speaks of it as being a missionary disciple, or the way I put it, to be a witness to Jesus in our lives. What I hope to do is very simply answer two questions. What is it we're supposed to do, and how do you and I do it every day? That's our plan for today. And before I answer either, I want to tell you a story. There once was a preacher in Texas, preacher of a small congregation, in a time when in the small little town where the church was located, they were experiencing a drought that began with a few days, then a few weeks, then a few months, and it dragged on and on. So like good Christians, like you and I are good Christians, they prayed for rain. And they prayed Sunday after Sunday after Sunday, and in the end, guess what happened? No rain. So the preacher said to the congregation, okay, we have to storm heaven. Let's go out, let's say our prayers, do our Sunday service, go out into the field, and we're going to storm heaven. We're going to pray until the sun sets, and they did. They prayed, they sang, they shared faith, the whole thing. Sunset. Guess what did not happen? It did not rain. So the preacher turned to the congregation and said to them, do you know why it didn't rain? It's your fault. Some of the people got really upset, very indignant. So they said to the preacher, well, what are you talking about? And this elderly woman, the oldest woman in the congregation, got up and said, preacher, that's really offensive. That's an insult. We have been praying just like you have all these months, all of today. How is it our fault that it hasn't rained? And the preacher said to her, it's simple. Who here brought an umbrella? Okay? You see the point. If you actually believed God was going to answer your prayers, why would you not act as if you believed it? See, that's the challenge. You and I have come here because we believe in Jesus, don't we? Right? And we believe he's our Lord and our Savior, don't we? And we want to be faithful Christians, don't we? All right. Which means that you and I should act, speak, and treat people differently from everybody else out there. That our lives have to be different, don't they? And St. James in his epistle talks about faith and works. And he says, show me your works and I will see your faith. Archbishop Fulton Sheen, one of the greatest catechists of the 20th century, who had, believe it or not, his own TV show every week, years before probably your parents were born. And he would preach to the entire country, the entire United States of America. And in one of his most famous homilies, he said this, if you do not act what you believe, you eventually believe how you act. So today, we need to look at connecting what we believe and how we act. And let me give you two questions, if I will. They're very blunt, but I told you I am from Brooklyn. They are blunt, and I want you to think about them. If a Christian is supposed to be someone who you immediately see is different, acts different, speaks different, something about them is not like everybody else. Since you arrived here today, how many Christians have you met? How many people that you have never met before, you met and said, wow, there's something special about that person? Or to ask the question another way, how many people could have met you since you got here and said, there is a Christian? See, that's what we're about here today. Please God, the answer would be yes for you and me. Now, I did not come here to tell you that what I'm about to present to you is easy, because it's not easy. It is never easy. Nothing worthwhile is ever easy in life. But it is worth doing, sacrificing, and fighting for, my friends. And no one knew that more than the ancient church. You remember the story of the apostles. You remember that on the night before Jesus died, the apostles were with him at the Last Supper. And soon after, they all left. They abandoned him, didn't they? Peter, to his face, three times denied Jesus. After he walked with him, ate with him, and saw all of the miracles and heard all of the preaching, when Jesus needed him the most, he turned his back on him. And yet we also know that after Jesus rose from the dead and they were filled with the power of the Holy Spirit, they lived, acted their faith in Jesus. And there was nobody and nothing on earth that would stop them. They went to the four corners of the world, St. Thomas as far as India, and they paid the price, all but one, of laying their life down for Jesus as a martyr. Even St. Paul, who was not an original apostle, died for Jesus. And in the first chapter of Corinthians, speaks of the power of the cross because they could not escape it, could they? For a penalty to be Christian was death. And so St. Paul says, to those who do not believe, the cross is crazy, just crazy. Because for a faithful Jewish person, the cross is not what Yahweh promised. He promised a life of blessing. So to expect to suffer is something that would be foreign to them. And to the Greeks and the Romans, crucifixion, the cross, was the symbol of power and might and oppression and fear to keep people in control, since the Romans controlled most of the known world. So to talk about the cross was simply unheard of. But the earliest apostles embraced it. And so did the disciples. You know what, my friends? When I was a priest 4 years, Bishop Daly, who was the Bishop of Brooklyn at the time, sent me to Rome to study. And I lived in Rome for 5 years. Five of the most difficult and most blessed years of my life. And while I was there, I often went out to eat because, I'm sorry, but some of the best food in the world is Italian food. Sorry. So one of my favorite restaurants was on the Via Appia Antica. It is a road that goes from the walled old city of Rome out into what used to be the fields and now is the city of Rome, because Rome has grown to a city of 5 million people. And one day I went to this restaurant and one of my professors taught me a very profound lesson. As we were walking towards the restaurant, which was a mile and a half, he said to me, Frank, he said, do you know why this road is important? I said, I have no idea. Is it because we're going to the restaurant? I don't know. What's the answer to the question? He said, do you realize that in the time of Nero, when the Christians were persecuted, he crucified them because they refused to give up their faith. They refused to act like everybody else, and he crucified them arm to arm the entire length of the road on both sides. Thousands and thousands of people put to death. And they did something the Romans hated. The Romans drove them crazy. For the Romans, with their pagan gods and the materialism and their unbridled sexuality and their promiscuity and their wealth, they had everything they thought they wanted. And these nagging, annoying Christians who Nero was going to stamp out, these Christians on their way to be crucified in their very last hours of life, they did something the Romans could not understand. They sang. They sang for joy. They sang the Psalms. They sang thanksgiving to the Lord Jesus. And the Romans sat there and said, what is it that these people have? What lets them do and live the way they do and actually pay this price? What is it that they have that we don't have? And of course, the answer, it's not a what. It's a who. It's a who. In their hearts were burning with faith and love of the Lord Jesus, and no one could take that away from them. And there was a famous scene 20 centuries later on the day Pope Benedict was made Pope, where Cardinal George, the Archbishop of Chicago, God rest his soul, was one of the first cardinals that came out on the balcony of St. Peter's. And he was off to the side. Pope Benedict was in the middle. He was off to the side. And there's in the square, there's thousands and thousands and thousands of people, priests and cardinals, all the action, welcoming the new successor of Peter. And Cardinal George is leaning against the wall, looking to the distance. And someone took a photo of him. And when he went back to Chicago, one of the news reporters said, Eminence, what were you looking at? I mean, all the action is in front of you. What were you looking at in the distance? And Cardinal George, who was probably one of the most intelligent men I have ever met, Cardinal George said to him, I was looking for Caesar because I can see Peter here in the square. But where is Caesar now, who put all those Christians to death? Where is Caesar now, who claimed to be God? He's gone, but Peter is still here. And that always reminds me, my friends, that no matter how difficult this is going to be for you and me, it is worth every minute of the struggle. For in the end, nothing will conquer the Lord Jesus. Nothing. So, what is it the Lord is asking of us? It begins with Jesus making the first step. Because every single one of us in this room, my friends, has received the gift of faith. It's a divine gift. It's the gift that allows you to recognize that God exists. And more than that, that God is alive in your hearts, that God walks with you every day of your life, that God is there who loves and accepts you, that this God does not live in the clouds, but he lives here in our midst, in you and me. That gift of faith also tells us that that God has a name, and his name is Jesus. God made man who in his death and resurrection has freed you and me from sin and death. How many of you own a pair of gloves? Raise your hand. Good. When you put your hand into your glove, it fits perfectly, doesn't it? Because your hand is made, or I should say the glove is made to fit your hand. The glove without a hand has no purpose. Well, this is what I'm going to tell you, my friends. You are made in the image and likeness of God. The book of Genesis. Which means you and I are made to recognize God's presence and in faith to see him and to respond to him. And what is it that Jesus offers? There's one word in this gift of faith. One word I want you to reflect on long after I'm gone. It's a word we use all the time. It's a word that most people don't understand. And the word is friendship. In the 15th chapter of St. John's Gospel, Jesus says something very interesting. Before I quote it, let me ask you a question. Give me one quality that describes a friend. Anybody, tell me. Loyalty, excellent. What else? Honesty, great. What else? Oh, I can't hear you, stand up, scream. Trustworthy, good. Faithful, good, great. Loving, now we're getting warmer, keep going. Courage? Okay. Excellent. Okay, my friends, let me quote Jesus. This is what Jesus says is the one characteristic of a friend. Greater love than this has no man than to lay down his life for his friends. Let me ask you another question. I alluded to it before. For 3 years, Jesus took these men, walked with them, fed them, taught them, guided them, prayed with them. They saw the miracle of the blind man seeing, the lame woman walking, and they saw Lazarus rise from the dead. He took them away with him. For 3 years, they lived their life together. Let me ask you this question then. Don't you think it's strange that in a world where we use the word friend all the time, you're my friend, I friend you, Jesus never called them friends until the night before he died. What I just quoted you. Why? Why wait till then? There is a reason. Because another way to define a friend is to say this. A friend is someone who sees you at your ugliest and still chooses to love you. Mama used to say, you can pick your friends, you can't pick your relatives. A true friend loves you always, in good times and in bad, in sickness and in health. Sounds familiar? Because husbands and wives are meant to be the best of friends. And if a marriage is not truly a friendship, that marriage will have great difficulty. So let's go back to Jesus. The night before he died, Jesus knew the apostles were going to betray him. He knew that they would run. He knew Peter would literally look him in the face and deny him. He knew, he saw, he understood their ugliest. And he still loved them. He still chose to die for them and us. Because the truth is, the whole world can turn its back on us, but Jesus never will. Right now, in your heart, there are secrets, aren't there? There are things that you are afraid, as I am, to let anyone else know. There are parts of your heart and mine that are not what they are meant to be. And you know what? Jesus already knows them. He sees them, and he still loves us. He still loves you. He will never love your sins, but he will always love you. How many of you speak a language other than English? Raise your hand. Oh, wow, most of you. Great. Great. Okay. How many of you speak Greek? Raise your hand. Greek. You do? Oh. Okay. So I'm going to give you a very small Greek lesson. Do you remember in the Gospel of St. John, after Jesus rose from the dead, he appeared on the seashore, and who did he meet? He met Peter. And do you remember Jesus asked him a question? Peter, do you love me? It's interesting. In English, we use the word love in all three questions because we have only one word for it. In Greek, there are three words for love. Eros, agape, and philia. And why that is really important is because the first time Jesus asked the question, he said, Peter, will you love me, agape? Will you love me perfectly as I love you? Second time, Peter, will you love me, agape? Will you love me perfectly as I love you? Yes, Lord. Third time, Peter, will you love me, philia? Will you be my friend? Lord, you know I love you. You see, Jesus gives us this gift of faith in baptism through the power of the Holy Spirit, offers us friendship, and the simple response back is for you and I to do the same. So in order to be a witness to Jesus, you can reduce it to simply asking yourself the question, what will I do for this, the most sincere, the most important, my divine friend? What is it that I will do for him? And Francis says, to be a witness. Let me tell you a story. When I was a seminarian in Brooklyn, I needed to go to court. And so one day I went to court, and I was told what I saw on television hundreds of times. Raise your right hand. Do you promise to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God? And I was sitting in the box, and my right hand began to shake. And I could feel the blood coming up in my face because I knew the next two words were extremely important because I was swearing myself to the truth. And I knew that if I did not tell the truth, the penalty would be severe. And so I said, I do, and gave my testimony. So when we say, what is the response? It's simple. I do. Somebody said that for you on the day of your baptism, five times. And how many of you here have been confirmed? You said it for yourself on the day God confirmed your baptism. You said, I do. Five times. And if it was just those five times, I do, I do, I do, I do, I do, I'm done, out the door, finished, easy. But it's not that. Because every choice from now on, for the rest of our lives, is another way to say, I do. I do to this Lord who has given me everything and to whom I want to respond back. It's a witness, not solely in words. It's to speak boldly our faith, to never be ashamed in public to say who we are and what we believe in. It is to live and act what we believe, to live a life of love and mercy, of truth and integrity, of chastity and purity. It is, in some way, to treat others as we would want them to treat us. And never to make a choice that compromises our friendship with the Lord Jesus. It's easy to say, hard to do. But that is what we are called to do. For in the end, my friends, there is no one way to be a witness. But there has to be some way every day to be a witness. So my last question is, how do we do this? Let me go back to my point about it not being easy. St. Ignatius of Antioch was a witness, and on his way to die, prayed that he would be like wheat to be ground in the mouth of a lion. Please God, none of us will be eaten by a lion. But let me tell you a story about Mother Teresa. You remember Mother Teresa, who lived in India, would go and beg for food. She would beg for small little children. And there's a famous story Bishop Barron speaks of in Catholicism, the video series, where Mother Teresa had a 7-year-old boy. And one afternoon, she took him to a bakery because he had not eaten for 3 days. And she had him by the hand, and she walked into the bakery, and the baker was standing by the counter. And Mother Teresa went up to the counter and said, "Sir, would it be possible to have one of those small loaves of bread to give to this boy?" And the man gave her a huge smile, and then he turned around. The bread was all here. So you would think he was going to take the bread and give it to Mother Teresa. But what he did was, he got himself ready, turned, and with Mother Teresa literally in front of him, he spit in her face. Now, I'm not sure what you would say at that moment. I will not tell you what I would have said at that moment. But I will tell you what she said. She said, "Sir, thank you for the gift you have given me. Now, what about the bread for the little boy?" No anger, no malice, no vengeance, a response of love. One I do in one moment. And whether that baker realized it or not, he was spitting into the face of a saint. So let me give you the recipe for how to do this. It's three steps. Step number one, ask yourself in this moment, on this day, in this place, what is it the Lord is asking? What is it that he's asking me to do? What is the mission? The mission. For it could be an act of kindness, gesture, word. It could be simply presence. It could be a thousand things. It could be simply with a friend, spending time with a friend who just needs an ear, or someone who has been lonely, or someone who just in some way, shape, or form needs to hear a kind word. It could be a thousand things. The mission always is before us, but we have to ask, Lord, what is it you want me to do? Let me tell you another story. There once was a young man who came to New York City on a leave. And this man never had the opportunity in normal life to sleep in. So his dream was to take 3 days in New York, sleep in, get up late, have a cup of coffee, a bagel, and just relax. He was in a hotel in Times Square, which, as you know, is in the center of the city. And this young man got up at about 9:45 in the morning. Usually he got up at 4:30 in the morning. And on this day, he comes out into Times Square, and even though he was not a New Yorker, immediately recognized that there was something very wrong. What he had no idea was the day he picked to have this leave was the day that changed the whole world. For as he looked into the distance downtown, he immediately recognized that both of the World Trade, first the first, and then eventually the second, was on fire. For this was the day our country was attacked by Al-Qaeda. And within a few minutes, as he's standing there making sense of what's going on, people began to walk and then run, first a few, then maybe 100, and then it was thousands of people. Remember, Manhattan has, in any given day, 5 million people on it. And they're running uptown. They're running away from everything that is unfolding downtown because people had no idea if this was the beginning of a world war, for all they knew. And this young man, ordinary like me, like you, did something extraordinary. He immediately, without thinking, started to go in the opposite direction, meaning he was walking towards Ground Zero, towards the disaster, not away. And in the city, the subways stopped running, the buses stopped running, eventually even planes stopped flying. And as more and more people, he was fighting his way down, and he began to run down the entire spine of Manhattan, and he arrived at what we call Ground Zero. And there was a man-made catastrophe. It was midnight. Smoke, soot, debris, death, all over. And he ran, not knowing what he was supposed to do, but he knew he had to be there. And when he arrived in all this chaos, he heard the voice of one person. And he found his way to the person. And the person was an old man who was pinned under cement and a steel girder off to the side and furniture and papers. And this man was screaming. Is there anybody out there who can help me? So this young man found his way to this older man, a man he had never met, obviously. And when he reached him, he was almost this close to him to be able to be seen. This old man started screaming louder. And he began to say, "Please do not leave me here to die." And this young man said something and did something extraordinary. He took the old man by the hand and he said, "Sir," he said, "I am a Marine. And a Marine never leaves his mission unaccomplished. And you are my mission." And for 11 hours, this young man stayed by this older man, tried to unpin him as much as he could, but he couldn't. I mean, the stuff was just too heavy. But he stayed with him until first responders could initially organize to try to help the first wave of survivors. Mission. It was clear. One person in front of him, in need. Mission. Where he responded, he knew what he had to do. Mission that is not ambiguous or compromised, or I do a little bit of this or a little bit of that, or I'll do lukewarm, or I'll do some for a little bit of time and then I'll leave, or after an hour I'm going to go do something else, I'm going to go have my bagel. No. Mission is mission. It's a task to be done, and we give it our full attention until it is accomplished or finished, or we have done everything that we can do. So the first step, my friends, for you and I is, later this afternoon, when you least expect it, and you have something that comes before you, what is the mission Jesus is asking for you to do right there, right at that moment? And if you are uncertain, ask for him to help you to see it. So that's step one, mission. Step two, to go to a person who is in need, whatever that person is. They will not always come to you. You have to go to them, like that man ran down the length of Manhattan. And it is true, especially as young people, you and I want to help the poor and the sick and the hungry and the homeless, absolutely. But there are other people who are poor who may not first look poor, and they also need our help. Let me tell you another story. Before I went into the seminary, I worked for McGraw-Hill, which is one of the largest publishing companies in the country. And my territory was all of New York City. And I had a grand old time. I loved it. Company car, expense account. I was traveling around, dining, taking people out. And my job was to keep my customers happy. I had one customer in particular, a very wealthy woman, owned a lot of schools. She bought half the books I sold. She did not like me for anything. And my job was to visit her every week. And every week it was the same thing. I would arrive, they would announce I was there, she'd come in, she'd start talking to me, and then she would turn her back and walk. And I would be walking behind her. She was always like five steps ahead of me. And we would get to the end of the hall, which was her office, and she would say to me, "Okay, if I need you, I'll call you." Walk in and slam the door in my face every week. It's New York. What can I tell you? Okay. So, in this period of time when I'm a salesman, I come to realize that it's God's way, not mine. That I can be stubborn, but Jesus said to me, "I gave you everything you want, and you have nothing you need. Are you happy?" And the answer is no, I wasn't. So I decided to go back to the seminary. So I went to the school to tell her that I was leaving. And this is what happened. I walk in, she's here. I say to her, so-and-so, I said, I'm here. And she goes, yeah, I know you're here. And she walks. I'm behind her. So I stop and I say, so-and-so, I said, I have news for you. I'm leaving. And she stops and she turns around. First time she's looking at me face to face. And she said, I knew you didn't have what it took to do this job. Thank you. Who is stupid enough to hire you? And I looked her straight in the face and I said, Jesus. And all of a sudden, her entire body changed. And she said to me, she almost whispered, she said, what did you just say? I said, Jesus. I said, I'm going back to the seminary. I'm going to give my life to the Lord. So this is goodbye. And she said, you, pointing to me, she said, you are not going anywhere. And she went to the office. She literally, the door swung open. And she walked in and told her secretary, who I'd never met, she said, you, cancel all my appointments. And she said, you, come into my office. And she sat down, and I sat down. And for 2 hours and 40 minutes, she told me her entire life. I didn't even know how to respond. And a woman who had so much wealth and power was also so hurt and so lonely, because poverty takes many forms. And as I walked out that school, the words of Philippians came to mind. At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bend in the heavens, on earth, and under the earth. And every tongue proclaim to the glory of God, Jesus Christ is Lord. It was the name of Jesus. But my point to you is this. There's not a person we're going to meet who is not in need. And sometimes it's not obvious, but it's extremely important. There will be friends and classmates who look as if they have their entire act put together. And yet there may be something there, a wound, a hurt, that has been hidden for a long time. And that may actually be you. And the truth is, mission could be to just allow ourselves the space to make friends with those we have left aside, cast off. Not smart enough, not good enough, not handsome enough, not in the in crowd. But that may be our mission. Because Saint Teresa puts it beautifully. Since Jesus' ascension, the only hands, feet, heart, knees, voice God has in the world is ours. So when we talk about mission and going out to those in need, you, my friends, like me, are going to be asked to be God's presence to that person. So it's a word of kindness or forgiveness. Is God speaking to them through us? Or it could be spending time tonight in prayer for a friend you know is going through a difficult time, that you become the knees of God. Or the hands of God for the people who are homeless or ill or sick or hungry. That in the end, all that we've been asked to do is to respond in friendship to Jesus. There is nothing we can give Jesus that he doesn't already have. He is God. But in his presence in the world, we can give the Lord a response of friendship through our neighbor and to become his hands and feet in the world. And lastly, you may be able to do it on the grand scale, but most of the time you're going to do it one person at a time. I'll tell you one last story. When I was at World Youth Day in Rio de Janeiro, there was a famous scene of Pope Francis. You may have seen it on the internet. They closed the street along the beach, and the security was tight. And Pope Francis was elected not long. And here he is in this limousine, this large limousine, coming down the street. And there was a man who had a son. And he literally, this man, took his son and threw his son at the Pope. Literally. So the security caught the kid, poor kid, and carried him over from guy to guy to guy to guy to guy. And there's the Pope. So his secretary brings the boy to the Pope and holds him up. And the Pope kisses the boy on the forehead. And the boy whispers something into the Pope's ear. And all of a sudden, the Pope changes. His face turns completely red. And I saw it with my own eyes. And you can see, as he was giving the boy back, that there were tears coming down the face of the Pope. And of course, no one knew what this little boy said. But the point is this. You're the leader of the Catholic Church. There are 350 television stations watching everything you do. There are 2 million people in the street. And the Pope taught me a profound lesson, that in that one moment, the only person that mattered was that little boy. And what the boy told the Pope later on was this. He said to the Pope in Spanish, "Papa," he said, "pray for me, because one day I want to be a priest." One person at a time. Is it easy? No. But you and I can do it if we know our mission right now, this moment. What are you asking, Lord? Have the courage to go out to the person we meet. We will be faithful missionary disciples of the Lord. But I have come here for one other reason. And I'm going to make this request really bluntly. I am here because you, my friends, as the young church, you are needed now more than ever to do this. Because what's the truth out there? We know the church is facing problems. We know that. I know that. And some have betrayed. Some have done great harm. And they've wounded the church and our credibility in the world. But those sins don't define who we are, do they? They do not. For we are the body of Christ in the world. There are people outside protesting, you may have seen, about how being a Catholic is itself a sin and will lead us to God knows what. Pope Francis is asking us to be missionary disciples because he's asking us to reestablish the credibility of our communities in the eyes of the world, to become effective witnesses of Jesus so that despite our sins and despite our problems, people will see this community is worth being part of. And that's why I'm appealing to you, because you are not the future of the church. You are the church here and now in our midst. You come here with energy and power. You come here with spirit. You come here with an enthusiasm. And quite frankly, you come here with expertise and knowledge I do not have. you know what? You are going to be the digital missionaries of the 21st century, my friends. It is you who are going to do it. And that's why everything I'm saying is for your own sake and for the sake of all of us, including me. It's about giving rebirth to our church, just like the ancient Christians did, and to show the world that there is good news. For we know the bad news. We know we live in a world that's polarized and divided and violent and with growing racism and discrimination and inequality. We know that the poor are getting poorer while the rich are getting richer. We know that there are more people homeless now than ever before, and the list goes on and on and on and on. And we know that there is also bad news in our midst. But there is good news. The gospel means good news. And let me tell you what the good news is. Christ has died, Christ is risen, and Christ will come again in glory. That is good news. Let me tell you good news. God has made you in his image, and he loves you beyond your wildest imagination, which makes your life worth living, no matter what challenge you and I may face. The good news is that despite the challenges people face, there are people out there who are willing to walk with them, love them, and accept them for who they are. And those people are you and me. That is the good news that brings us here. And you know what? The good news is every single one of us is a sinner in this room. Every single one of us. Every single one of us has said to Jesus to his face, I do not know you, by our choices and our sins. And the good news is Jesus says to you in return, do you love me, Philia? Will you be my friend? That is a question he will always ask you. And he is always ready to hear the words, I do. That is the good news in our midst. And so, this is my advice to you. As your spiritual father and as a brother in faith, never be afraid to be great in Jesus. Never be afraid to be different. Never be afraid to not be part of the crowd, go with the flow, or be like everybody else. Never be afraid to be different for the sake of Jesus. Never be afraid to be his witness. Because you know what, my friends? Your destiny is to be great in Jesus Christ. So you know what? I have no idea whether it rained in that town in Texas. But this much I do know. Chances are, Monday morning, everybody in that congregation went to the store and bought an umbrella. Okay? Because you know what? They were praying for it to rain. It is already raining right here, right now. That rain is not made of water, it's made of grace. Because who is our King and who reigns in our midst? but Jesus the Lord, who for whom we are his witnesses. And so, my friends, I promise to pray for you, and I ask you to please pray for me. Together, let us answer the challenge to be the hands, the feet, and the voice of God in the world, and to show the world that there is one above all others we love, whom we call our friend, and his name is Jesus. Thank you all, and God bless you.
Thank you, Bishop, for the absolutely amazing talk.
Can we give Bishop Caggiano one more round of applause? And before we leave, do you think we can do the Jesus chant one more time? Yeah! All right, let's do it. Jesus!
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 Oh! All right, thank you guys. Have a good rest of your day.
So why aren't you here?